the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to our second Sunday in Advent. As Jerusalem did, we stand in faith-filled waiting. We rise, assured by John that the promised one will baptize with the Holy Spirit. Standing in God's holy presence, we ask for mercy. Lord Jesus, you are the promised Prince of Peace. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you are the promised Wonderful Counselor. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the promised Messiah. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, may no earthly undertaking hinder those who set out in haste to meet your Son, but may our learning of heavenly wisdom gain us admittance to his company, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Comfort gives comfort to my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her service is at an end. Her guilt is expiated. Indeed, she has received from the hand of the Lord double for all her sins. A voice cries out, in the desert, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the wasteland a highway for our God. Every valley shall be filled in. Every mountain and hill shall be made low. The rugged land shall be made a plain. The rough country a broad valley. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Go up onto a high mountain, Zion, herald of glad tidings. Cry out at the top of your voice, Jerusalem, herald of good news. Fear not to cry out, and say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. Here comes with power the Lord God, who rules by his strong arm. Here is his reward with him, his recompense for him, before him. Like a shepherd, he feeds his flock. In his arms, he gathers the lambs, carrying them to his bosom, and leading the ewes with care. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Reading from the second letter of St. Peter. Do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like one day. The Lord does not delay his promise, as some regard delay, but he is patient with us, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a mighty roar, and the elements will be dissolved by fire, and the earth and everything done on it will be found out. Since everything is to be dissolved in this way, what sort of person ought you to be, conducting yourselves in holiness and devotion, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be dissolved in flames and the elements melted by fire? But according to his promise, we await new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, since you await these things, be eager to be found without spot or blemish before him, at peace. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the Isaiah, the prophet, "Behold, I am sending my messenger ahead of you. He will prepare your way." A voice of one crying out in the desert, "Prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight his paths." John the Baptist appeared in the desert, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. People of the whole Judean countryside and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem were going out to him, and they were being baptized by him in the Jordan River as they acknowledged their sins. John was clothed in camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist. He fed on locusts and wild honey. And this is what he proclaimed: "One mightier than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop and loosen the thongs of his sandals. I have baptized you with water. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." The Gospel of the Lord. Whether you're watching online, live, or Memorex, as we used to say years ago, or on Facebook, YouTube, or in the church, we realize by just looking at the church, looking at the vestments the priest has on, we're looking at the two candles lit, purple candles, that we're in the midst of the Advent season, and we're in the second Sunday of Advent. And last week, we heard in the Gospels to prepare for the coming of the Lord. And we do not know the day nor the hour. So we can look at today preparing for December 25th or the day of the Lord, whenever that may be, meaning the end of time or the end of our time here on earth. But we can also look ahead past December 25th. And some cultures celebrate Little Christmas, usually January 6th, is more important than December 25th. This year, the church gives us January 3rd as a Sunday, and we'll be celebrating the Feast of the Epiphany. And then on the following Sunday, the Feast of the Baptism of the Lord. And I say those things because they point to important parts of what we're about today, on the second Sunday of Advent. Those are gifts to us over time. And today, of course, on Epiphany, the Magi, the three kings, show up and bring their three gifts. And today, on the second Sunday of Advent, I'd like to talk about three different gifts that we can experience today in 2020 and that were experienced years ago. First one is offered by St. John the Baptist. His mission, his goal, his gift was that he preached and offered a baptism of repentance to the Jewish people and, of course, to us today. Now, our Christian baptism is different. It's not only for the forgiveness of original sin, but it's also for entering into the church as well as its water and the Holy Spirit. John the Baptist helps us prepare for the way of the Lord, whenever the Lord is coming, December 25th, or any time in our lives. John's message is to be prepared for when the Lord comes, whenever that is. Our second gift is from Jesus himself. We know that Jesus is the light of the world. We know that from our Easter celebrations, or if you've been to a funeral or a baptism recently, the large candle, the Easter candle we light three times during the year, and I say this at funerals and baptisms and certainly at Easter. We are an Easter people, even though this is Advent. We have to keep in mind that we celebrate the death and resurrection of Jesus. I think Catholics are very good at celebrating or entering into the Lenten season, giving up chocolate, giving up ice cream, giving up whatever, or doing something that maybe we're uncomfortable doing. And we do that with sad faces for 40 days. And the church knows that. So the church reminds us and celebrates with us for 50 days Jesus overcoming sin, death, and darkness by his life, death, and resurrection. So we celebrate for 50 days Jesus overcoming the darkness of the world. The darkness of the world adds to our sin, and his death and resurrection overcomes that. And his gift to us is the baptism by water and the Holy Spirit that John the Baptist pointed to so many years ago. If you look at those two together, the repentance of sin and the entering into newness of life through Jesus Christ, we come to where we need to each day in our lives examine where we are in our relationship with God. And some religious communities, the Jesuits come to mind, have what they call the daily exam. And all that is at the end of the day, to take a few moments and just think about how God was present in our lives. What good God brought to us, and how perhaps we shared it or didn't share that goodness with others. Some would call it the examine, some would call it an examination of conscience, which is an excellent way to do that. And you don't have to do that just when you're coming to confession. We can do that each day. And perhaps we can use that during our Advent season as preparation for the Lord's coming this Christmas time. All it takes is a few minutes. Now, you can Google it, you can look it up on different websites, different religious orders, perhaps even the United States Catholic Conference of Bishops would have something. And it's just a series of questions. You can come up with your own. Here are some suggestions from my point of view. The first one I think is important to start it off and just ask yourself, how was my day? Where do I see God present in that day? Where do I see God was present, but I wasn't really open to God's presence? A big one for me is, especially when I'm stuck in traffic and I'm running late, which I apologize today. I wasn't necessarily stuck in traffic and I did not have any problem with my language, but that's a question that I usually have to ask myself if I was stuck in traffic earlier. How was my language? How was your language? Sometimes we slip, sometimes we say bad words, as kids would say. How do I treat others? How did I treat others that particular day? Did I pray? How did I pray? Did I pray for something for me or for others? Which was more important during that prayer time? How did I use my time today? Did I use the talents, the God-given talents that God has given us properly on that particular day? And a big one. What do I need to do today, tomorrow, to change my life so that I will be better prepared for the coming of the Lord, whether it's December 25th or some other day? I need to add, it's not the time to be thinking about how we can change others. Many times people have come to me, both as a priest, as a deacon, and even as a layperson who just went to church. I have a problem with fill in the blank, my brother, my sister, my son, my daughter, my grandchild, my nephew, my niece, my parent. How How can they get them to change? The answer is, we can't. What we can do is we can pray for them, and we can give them an example. And I've used this one before, where when I was still living in California, before I was a priest, I'd go away with some friends who were all churchgoers. Many of us were in ministry together. But we would go Friday, Saturday, and sometimes extend that to Sunday. If it was a Sunday, I would try to find a church to go to that church, Catholic church, obviously. And some friends would say, just take the weekend off. We go every other week. It's okay. Well, it may be okay for you, but I want to go to church. And as an example, and because of my relationship, perhaps that would change some minds. And some people have said, well, I'm at my in-law's house, or I'm at someone else's house, and I don't have transportation. Do you ask them, say, I need to go to church? Even if they're not willing to give you a ride, or they don't want to give you get a taxi, or you can't afford it, or whatever, you're giving them an example that you're thinking about going to church. Maybe that helps change them. One of the great examples in our church history was Saint Monica, the mother of Saint Augustine. For years, she prayed for his conversion. He finally was converted. Not from anything in particular that she did other than praying, and perhaps her great example of going to church, of believing in God, convinced Saint Augustine. All we can do is change ourselves, pray for others, and show them how we live. And the third and final gift, not necessarily from some person, but from the church. The church has given us these 4 weeks of Advent, 4 Sundays, and almost 4 full weeks of Advent to prepare not only for this December 25th, 2020, but for the day of the Lord, the coming of the Lord into our world, into our hearts, now and in the future. Perhaps it's a time to re-invite Jesus into our hearts and into our homes, and to be open to God's presence, to reflect on our baptism and the forgiveness of sins by water and the Holy Spirit and the other sacraments that we have in the Catholic Church. What is required for each one of us in our faith, each and every day of our life, today and going forward? Perhaps that's meant for us to take just a few minutes each day. This week, starting today, take a moment and see the gifts that God has given each one of us. Because your examination doesn't have to be, oh, I did this wrong, I did that wrong, I did this wrong. It can start with all the goodness that God has shared with each one of us. And then look how we didn't accept those gifts or use them properly. This way, we examine our lives and we become better prepared for the Lord's coming. And ultimately, to thank God at the end of each day for all the gifts that God has given us. Sometimes we forget some of those. Especially to thank God for the gift of giving us his Son at Christmas and at every day of our life. Let us say our Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell, and on the third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Lord, You give comfort and peace to Your people. We come before You with the prayers of our hearts.
For our Holy Father, Pope Francis, and all bishops and priests, that they will shepherd the Church with wisdom and loving compassion, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For civil servants and government officials, that they will provide comfort to those who seek assistance, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all expectant parents anxious for a new child, or those who hold a vigil with loved ones facing death, that they find peace after hope-filled waiting, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For members of our community, especially those who are unable to be with us this day, that we may all faithfully await new heavens and a new earth, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those affected by abuse in the world, that they find healing, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the names in our Book of Prayer petitions and our three worship sites, and for all who have died, Father Joe George from St. John's, and especially those who have died during this pandemic. And we remember in a special way Steve Sullivan, deceased members of O'Connell and Metzler families, Pat and Maureen Fox, Bridget Hand, James Lesueur, Marie Evangelista, Elvira Parent, and all in our One Faith community, we pray to the Lord.
And all those who have recently been baptized. Yesterday we baptized Trevor Kreischer, the family that comes here with the three kids. Now they have four, we congratulate them, and we ask prayers for Trevor as well as for all their family and loved ones. We pray to the Lord. God of goodness and grace, may we heed Isaiah's message as we strive to prayerfully prepare the way of the Lord through the same Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. And attention, Faith Formation families. Our biblical reference this week is Matthew 26, verse 28. That's Matthew chapter 26. Verse 28.
Thank you.
sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept our sacrifice at your hands, the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all his church.
Be pleased, O Lord, with humble prayers and offerings. And since we have no merits to plead our cause, come, we pray, to our rescue with the protection of your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up, Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he assumed at his first coming the lowliness of human flesh, and so fulfilled the design you formed long ago, and opened for us the way to eternal salvation, that when he comes again in glory and majesty, and all is at last made manifest, we who watch for that day may inherit the great promise of which now we dare to hope. And so with the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, Jesus took the chalice, and once more giving thanks to you, Father, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. We offer you, Heavenly Father, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Jesus Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Edward, our Bishop, Howard, our Bishop Emeritus, with all the clergy, religious, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, glorious martyrs, St. Catherine of Siena, St. James, St. John the Baptist, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
communion prayer. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you.
I have more.
Let us pray. Replenished by the food of spiritual nourishment, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that through our partaking in this mystery, you may teach us to judge wisely the things of earth and hold firm to the things of heaven, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, everyone, for your participation in this liturgy today. A couple of quick announcements. First, this week, there's a Holy Day of Opportunity on December 8th, on Tuesday. The Mass will be at Our Lady of Knot Shrine at 10:30 a.m., and then we'll follow that by Adoration of the Blessed Sacrament until about 4 p.m. For Mass, you do need to register through Flock Note. For Adoration, you do not. And then for Reconciliation, that afternoon from 3 to 5 p.m., also out at the Shrine. Again, no registration is needed. There will be no Mass this Wednesday, just on Tuesday at the Shrine. The Memorial Angel Tree used to be just the Angel Tree, but we are renaming it for Pat Steinhauer, who used to be the one in charge of it for many years. Please see the bulletin for details on that. The registration for Tuesday's Mass is due by noon on Monday. And then Flock Note, you need to sign up weekly. Thank you for those who have been doing that. You see now we've expanded it to put the names on the pews if you've registered in advance, so we appreciate that. The registration each week closes usually on Friday at 12 noon. If you're calling in after that, please call the Sacred Heart office, not St. John's, because they're closed on Friday. But you can call in until 2:30 if you don't have access to a computer. Please don't call Saturday morning or Sunday morning and say, hey, I want to come. You missed the boat. Sorry. Also, for Christmas, the deadline is next Sunday at 2 p.m., December 13th at 2 p.m. for Christmas Masses. As of yesterday, we had still about 10 seats or so available for our Senior Citizen Mass at 2 p.m. at the Shrine on Christmas Eve, and about 10 or 12 for the St. John's 4:30 Mass on Christmas Eve. The question came up, it's going to be the family mass at St. John's at 4:30 with children, but there is no pageant this year because of the pandemic. And then there are still many seats available on 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. on Christmas Day. And then if you took home or you're interested in donating for the nursing homes or the VA for the SOP drive that we're having, those gifts need to be returned by next Sunday as well. And I think that's it. Look for the bulletin for more information. Please bow down for the blessing. May the Almighty and merciful God, by whose grace you have placed your faith in the first coming of his only begotten Son and yearn for his coming again, sanctify you by the radiance of Christ's advent and enrich you with his blessing forever.
Amen.
As you run the race of this present life, may he make you firm in faith, joyful in hope, and active in charity forever.
Amen. Amen.
So that rejoicing now with devotion at the Redeemer's coming in the flesh, you may be endowed with the rich reward of eternal life when he comes again in majesty forever and ever.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your lives.
Thanks be to God.
Sacred Heart of Jesus.
Have mercy on us.
Our Lady of Knot.
Intercede for us.
St. John the Baptist.
Pray for us.